And
oh, I can eat stuff. Are you saying anyway, or am I just
Well, I can just.
I can say a couple of words.
I don't have the ticket, do I?
You sit on
it. I said no.
Welcome, Tim and Becky. Nice to have you here. And Kim. And Mary.
Graham.
And Graham. Yeah, he's still there.
He's there.
I don't think I need to say very much apart from welcome. This morning we had an incredibly stimulating session on the idea of whether there is meaning, and it was challenging us to think about some of the history of ideas. If you start us with Stravinsky and frighten the life out of us all with that. I don't think I want to say any more. If you just do the briefest summary of the last session as we come into this one, that's okay.
Yeah, I do. Yes, I will do that in a couple of paragraphs.
So and let me just pray for you.
You pray, yeah.
Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for the chance to enjoy this time together. Thank you for Hugh's years of expertise and thought on this subject. And we pray that in all of this, you would equip us better to love you and to love others, to engage with your world, and to love people well. Pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Well, good evening, everybody. I hope you've had a good afternoon, and it's wonderful to be looking at some more music together. I'm going to jump right in with some music. And if you have something to write with or type on, or maybe you just make great mental notes, I don't know, that's fine. But I want to play two pieces. They belong side by side. That one will run into the other. And just as you listen to this music, is this working? Yes. Just jot down anything you're feeling, anything you're hearing, any response to what you're hearing at all. There'll be a section of orchestral music only, and then the second piece you'll notice is the introduction of some voices. This is about 9 minutes in total, just to give you an idea of what we're doing. So about 9 minutes for two pieces, and yeah, just make some mental notes or jot down type any response you get while we listen to this. Oh, I forgot there's a long bit of silence at the beginning of this track, so I'm just going to talk and it won't be so embarrassing.
Awkwardness.
Any second now. Unless, of course, I didn't press the clicker. Thank you. Possibly Joseph Haydn's greatest masterpiece, The Creation. You probably guessed that. And I hope that provides an effective link between where we left off this morning and where I would like us to pick up this evening. Just to recap a little bit on this morning, we finished our session earlier with, of course, Genesis 1. And we saw that account of God creating the heavens and the earth. And his observations that it was good. It was good. It was good. It was good. And then, of course, eventually, it was very good. And we also saw this morning how C.S. Lewis argues persuasively in The Abolition of Man against the aesthetics of modernity, stating his case that a thing can have inherent value. It can have inherent meaning, and so on, in itself and in relation to other things. And that is, of course, in opposition to modernity, which was saying this was impossible. Stravinsky himself was saying music could not carry meaning, and so on. So our starting point this morning was that question, can music mean anything? And I really believe that with Genesis 1 open in front of us, we have to side with Lewis in this argument, and rather than Igor Stravinsky, we have to answer, yes, music can and does mean something. Lewis famously illustrated this point in the Chronicles of Narnia. Many of you will probably know this quote. In chapter 14 of The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, you'll remember if you've read the books, the intrepid adventurers meet with the star at rest. You know this one? Ramandu. And during their conversation, there's the following exchange. Here they are talking to a star. You know, how does that work? And in our world, said Eustace, a star is a huge ball of flaming gas. Even in your world, my son, that is not what a star is, but only what it is made of, says Ramandu. The point is clear. And so often in the book, in The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, Eustace is the voice of modernist materialism. And thus, in his understanding, in his world, a star is a huge ball of flaming gas, which, of course, is true. Lewis is not arguing with that. Eustace's error is in thinking that that is all a star is, its physical attributes. But a thing is much more than its physical properties. We saw that in Genesis 1. And God saw it was good. A thing can possess inherent value, inherent beauty, personality, meaning, goodness, or otherwise, and much more, both in itself and in relation to other things. So, if you're with me this far, and if you're ready to agree that music is capable of possessing both value and meaning, the next question has to be, doesn't it, how? How is this possible? How can music contain meaning, which can be examined, which can be understood, which can be assessed? And the answer to this question will take us most of the rest of the sessions this week, because the short answer is, in various ways. How does music carry meaning? Well, various ways. And I'd like us to examine at least some of these various ways in our time together. And I'm going to try and do this in a sort of chronological manner, okay? So I'm going to try and look back about 200 years from Stravinsky and then move forward and let's get back to Stravinsky towards the end of the week. Now, we could have gone back further in history than 1700 or so. We could have gone back into the Renaissance. We could have gone back further. But I've chosen not to do that for two reasons. Firstly, we don't have enough time. Secondly, once we get before the music of 1700, I get a little bit out of my depth as well. And so I don't want to start blagging. But I'm reliably informed by people who know their Renaissance music and previous, earlier, that if we were to go back further in time, we really wouldn't hit anything to contradict or to disprove what I'm trying to do here, in restricting us just to three centuries or so. So, we've had a brief assessment of the state of the playing field today in terms of how we got here from the last century, from Stravinsky and so on. So let's go back and let's start to move forward. And in this session, I'd like us to look at two models of musical meaning, of how composers infuse meaning into their music. And these two models are representation, first of all, and then secondly, symbolism. So firstly, representation. That example we just heard, that Haydn example, we started with that. That comes from a little later than the period I wanted to look at this evening, but it was so pertinent I couldn't resist including it. Do you remember that first section we heard? Just the orchestral, but before the voices were introduced. What do you think it might have been communicating? What did you note down? What did you hear? Now you can use your ears or you can use your theology here for some educated guesswork if you prefer. But what did you hear? Just in the orchestral stuff. We'll talk about the voices in a moment. Anybody?
Majesty or reverence.
Right, yeah. Some very big gestures there,
weren't there? Crescendos.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Good. Anything else?
Discords resolving.
Yes, a lot of dissonance. And sometimes resolving in unusual ways. Thinking they were going to resolve this way and then they went another way. And so on. Yeah. Yeah. Good.
A mixture of major and minor keys quite a lot as well.
Yeah. Yes, and some very strange modulation, you know, change of keys modulation. So yes, very distant keys, unusual keys, yeah, good. Melodies that didn't really go anywhere, you think, oh, here's a tune, and then it sort of dissolves. You notice that? Rhythms constantly changing, shifting. Anything else?
Tohu vohu.
What?
Formless and void.
Well, fortunately for us, the composer tells us what he's representing in this case. And this is, in Haydn's words, the representation of chaos. It's the musical imagining of Genesis 1, verse 2. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. Before he gives us, you know, Genesis 1, 1, tries to imagine musically this formlessness and this darkness over the face of the deep. Now that's a highly stylized version of chaos. Stravinsky would have come up with something quite different, I'm sure, for a representation of chaos. But in the language of the late 18th century, actually that's early 19th century, but you know, Haydn's very much in the late 18th century style here. This is incredibly strange music. Those bizarre key changes, we talked about lopsided phrases rather than phrases balancing in length. They don't balance. Unusual orchestration and all this stuff that we've already mentioned, the dissonance and so on. They'd all communicate chaos with stunning eloquence to audiences of Haydn's day. Setting the scene, of course, for these 6 days of creation, of ordering and filling, and so on. But the important point for us here at the moment is that what we've got here is representation. The composer is saying to us, in effect, here's a musical, an extra musical event that I am going to depict, I'm going to portray in music. This is the essence of representation. And of course, it's very nice for us as listeners in search of meaning when a composer tells us what he is or she is trying to convey, of course. It's rather like a painter tells us what landscape they're depicting or who the subject is of a portrait. We don't need to ask ourselves the question, well, what is being represented here, do we? And by the way, bear in mind with representation, this approach may be very nice for us, but it's a very bold move on the part of the artist, because after all, we as their audience might know the subject that they are depicting or painting or depicting in music, and we might be rather unimpressed with the artist's likeness. So the challenge of representation is a very bold move on the part of the artist. Well, I hope you agree that Haydn did a good job of representing chaos as well as light, those of you who jumped. Now, representation was nothing new to 18th century audiences. Composers in the Baroque period. The Baroque period would run, depending on your textbook, from, let's say, 1685 to 1750, something like that. Composers in the Baroque period seem to love the challenge of representation in music. And perhaps none more so than Antonio Vivaldi. Now, if you're not familiar with any of the other musical examples I use this week, that is really fine. Some of them are going to be well off the beaten track. But if you only know one of the examples I use this week, the chances are it's going to be this next one, especially if you like classical. Vivaldi wrote his famous set of violin concerti, The Four Seasons, in 1717, we think. But they were first published in the 1720s. And since that first performance, they've been hugely popular pieces with audiences. Since, you know, the advent of recording, literally hundreds of recordings have been made of these four violin concerti. Those of you over a certain age will remember Nigel Kennedy recording these in 1989. Sold over 2 million copies, which is staggering for a piece of classical recording. One of the best-selling classical records of all time, Nigel Kennedy. But there's a good reason for the fact that the Four Seasons seems to connect so well with audiences. And we can forget this, and musicians forget this especially. That reason is that it is very, very good music. You know, professional musicians will roll their eyes and say, oh goodness, you know, Four Seasons again. But actually, this is brilliant, brilliant music. And what makes the music of very special interest to us for our discussion this evening is that Vivaldi published these pieces with accompanying sonnets, with poems, explaining what he was representing in the music. And this is a very bold move, as I've mentioned earlier, because you could enjoy this music for what it is. But when we enjoy it with the program that Vivaldi gives us, I think we really get a sense of how direct music can be in conveying meaning. So let's take a look at one of these sonnets. I picked one at random. I thought, well, we're in winter, so let's have a look at winter. Now, what do you notice here? The square brackets I've added, the rest. So Vivaldi has divided up the sonnet into the three movements of the concerto for us. So that helps us even more to know which bit applies to which bit of the music. So I've simply added first movement there, but everything else he's given us. And let's just have a look here. You'll hear a short gap between the movements. But notice what he is depicting here. To tremble from cold in the icy snow. This doesn't, you know, read as great English poetry. This is in translation, of course. To tremble from cold in the icy snow, in the harsh breath of a horrid wind, to run, stamping one's feet every moment, our teeth chattering in extreme cold, before the fire to pass peaceful, contented days while the rain outside pours down. Second movement. Third movement. We tread the icy path slowly and cautiously, for fear of tripping and falling, then turn abruptly, slip, crash on the ground, and rising, hasten on across the ice. Lest it cracks up, we feel the chill north winds course through the home despite the locked and bolted doors. This is winter, which nonetheless brings its own delights. So, we're going to listen. It's about 10 minutes in total for all three movements. It's not a long piece. So let's listen to this all the way through. And once again, just jot down, take any notes. Particularly interested in how much of this detail you feel you can identify in the music. Okay? If you're not quite sure how to describe what's going on in the music, that's okay. But just, you know, if you think, I can hear that, I can hear that, I can hear that feature there. That's fine, just jot it down, see how much you think, and how successful, really, you think Vivaldi is in depicting his meaning. Let's give this a go. Starts very quiet. Thank you.
Thank you.
There we have it. So any thoughts? What did you notice? Was Vivaldi successful in depicting what he said he was going to do? How much of that did you feel you heard? Anybody?
Definitely the crash, like the music
that arrives. Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh. This is the third movement. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that opening with a kind of very wobbly sort of violin line, you can just imagine that sort of,
oh my goodness, I'm going to fall in.
And then, of course, the crash comes. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, good. Any other features? Any order? You don't feel good.
The rain outside.
The rain, yeah, that was very effective. That's right, pizzicato strings. Yeah, good.
The second movie was definitely just like safer.
Right.
Felt.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Than the first and the second.
Yes, very evocative, wasn't it? This sort of passing, what is it, peaceful days, contempted by the fire while the rain falls down. Yeah, so definitely, yeah.
Kind of has like the nice peace and resolution at the end.
Uh-huh. Right. Yes. Yeah. This north wind blowing, I think, right at the end. He doesn't quite do everything quite in the same order. That's all right. Yeah. You know, this stylist. He knows he's got to get his musical form right as well. He's not, you know, singing his diary. That's all right. But yeah, I think. Yeah. Anyway, let's keep going. Yeah.
Stamping of the feet as well, the rhythm at the first.
Yes.
Time, that was there all the time.
Yeah, real fun stuff. Particularly that performance, which is particularly good, I think.
The way he uses the escalation for
right.
Swirling.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
And teeth chattering.
Yes. Well. Yeah. Yeah.
And high shivering violin.
Yeah.
That's right. At the very beginning.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. It's sort of crisp, frosty feel to me. Yeah.
Could it be snowflakes too?
Right, yeah.
Do you think even using high notes for ice or for
yes.
cold?
Yeah, it's got that very cold feeling to it, yeah.
I thought the first movement felt a lot brighter than I expected.
Right.
Because almost when you read it, the kind of horrid wind, mm-hmm. yeah. thinking maybe being dark, but his illustrations seem quite like a bright,
right.
crisp.
Yes. Yes.
Winter morning, uh-huh. as opposed to like a dark winter.
Night. Bleak. Yes. Yes. I think that's right. Yeah. Yeah.
This is a brightness to the coldness.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
I was going to ask, mm-hmm. I think he does a good job of describing the physicality of the wind.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure he's right to, well, that question to Vivaldi, but to. Put emotions to it. So, for example,
right.
Coleridge, because I would say that the freedoms in the first movement and the last movement and the second movement contented, I found to
right.
claustrophobic.
Okay.
So,
interesting.
So, I wonder if, you know, I think there's a description of the physicality of the material world, but I
yes.
wonder would people interpret their emotions.
Right, yeah, that's an interesting point. And yeah, I think. That's a very pertinent point, actually, because I think his main interest here is on the sort of the physicality. But he does, you're right, you know, he does have these things about contented states and so on. And there are some emotional language in there as well, which we might catch or we might not, or we might feel doesn't quite work. But, yeah, any other comments, any other observations? I mean, I think we're doing very well here.
Just the second movement. The recording that I'm familiar with plays the second movement much more slowly.
Right.
And
yeah.
It feels more relaxed. And
okay.
It's just interesting that you reacted that way, Kate.
Right.
And there's also a lot more notes in this one.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it must be something to do with notation at the time or something.
Yeah, there's a certain amount of improvisation. So right. the idea was that there would be elements of a violinist expected to elaborate. Yeah. Which some people do and some people don't. So, yeah. But I mean, this is all by way of illustrating, really, that the we could, you know, I could turn that screen off, and you've probably heard this music before, and even if you've not, you could enjoy that without any of this here. But I think with this here, and of course Vivaldi is inviting us to do this, you know, they're published side by side, the sonnet and the music. He wants us, he's challenging us to say, so how am I doing? You know, it's a very bold proposition. He could have just given us the music and we would have enjoyed it, and we might have speculated a bit about what it was about. But he's saying, this is what it's about. What do you think? This is very confident art. And I think in general we'd agree, you know, that is very emotive, that's very strong representation. You know, having been told what it is, this is music that's really loaded with meaning, with significance, with a story in that sense. Not necessarily a narrative sense, but in terms of he helps us to see in our mind's eye what he wants us to see. Okay, so much for representation. Let me just knock this. Because we're going to think about something else.
If representation, sorry, I was just remembering something. It's so interesting what you said about the art. It's a challenge for the artist to do that by basically saying, "This is what I'm representing."
Yes.
And because I remember listening to something about an author being asked what their work meant, and they were so reticent to pin it down because I think they wanted to leave everything open,
right?
So they could almost be, "Oh yeah, that's what you do now. That's what you do now." They
right.
didn't want to say.
Yes.
But I say in yourself, it's such a challenge to do that, isn't it?
Right.
So,
yeah. And so, yeah, I think it is a very confident composer, and we see that. Yeah. Yeah. So that's representation, you know, a very direct, okay, I'm going to try and depict in sound a visual, largely visual images there. And if that's the most straightforward or the most direct vehicle, if you like, for carrying musical meaning, we're going to think about something now that's a little more obscure, but I hope it's not too obscure. And we're going to think about symbolism. Because not even Vivaldi had a program for every piece of music he wrote. And he did write over 600 concertos. And he didn't have a program for every single one. And Vivaldi and his contemporaries enjoyed exploring other ways of conveying meaning. Not least by means of musical symbolism. And at this point I want to think about Bach for a while, Johann Sebastian Bach. He worked for a significant part of his life in the employment of the Lutheran Church. And that kept him very busy writing weekly cantatas. A cantata is a vocal choral work for church services. And that meant he would write a new cantata every Sunday. Imagine going to Bath Church. You've got a premiere every week for 4 years. Wow. Anyway, and then of course I add special feast days in the church calendar. You get some big. You might, you know, at Easter especially, we've got the St. Matthew Passion, St. John Passion, Christmas cantatas, and so on. So working with voices and texts, which Bach did a lot of. That means, of course, that you can convey meaning. You have a big head start in conveying meaning. We heard that in the Haydn, didn't we? As soon as you hear that familiar text, Genesis 1 in that case, you've got that something to hang your hat on, to hang your meaning. And Bach did a lot of that in his church music, in his vocal music. The text is carrying the main burden of the meaning, and then the music's sits in a supporting role. Thus, in much of Bach's sung music, you'll find plenty of musical representation, this kind of thing. Bach sets biblical texts wonderfully for his singers, with the musical accompaniments set up to reinforce and to represent a lot of the pictorial detail or the emotional meaning. I just made a quick note here, you know, just from some of the Bach I've been listening to recently. Wandering sheep, floggings, baying enemies, Peter's tears, angel choirs, so on, so on, all get an almost cinematic representation in Bach's vocal and choral pieces. And even that in and of itself, it struck me as I was thinking about this, gives us a reminder of how colourful and varied the images God gives us in the Bible. Because Bach is just often picking up an image that he's finding in his Bible text, and he's putting it colourfully in the music. And it makes you realise, wow, yeah, God's word has got all this colour in it. He's just taking it and representing it in sound. But what about when Bach was not working with words? Well, Bach also loved numbers and was quite a formidable mathematician. Now, Christians have long, through history, had a love of the number three. Can anybody guess why? It's Trinitarian association. And thus a good Lutheran, as well as a genius like Bach, especially wouldn't pass up the opportunity to utilize the symbolism of the number three in his art. And perhaps Bach's most famous and admired work of purely instrumental music now, without voices, it may well be the Brandenburg Concerto number three, funnily enough. So we're going to try, let's see, I hope this is going to work. I'm going to try and show a video. So let's hope this works. This is a magnificent performance of the Bach Brandenburg Concerto number three, and it's by the Netherlands Bach Society. If you like Bach, or if you would like to get to know Bach, you're going to want to go to www.allofbach.com. It's your new best friend. It's restored my faith in the internet. It's that good. And I have no association. I'm not plugging or getting any material benefit from encouraging you this way. So this is Bach Brandenburg 3. Again, if you want to jot down anything you feel, anything you observe, particularly anything to do with the number 3, visually as well as what you hear in sound, just make a note of that. Well, let's go if I just click it up.
Just click more and it should go. There they are.
Here we go. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any observations? Did you see any threes or hear any threes in there? Nothing to see.
Musicians were in trios, like with the violin.
Right. Yep, so there were three. On the left you had three violins, on the right you had three violas, and then the middle, three cellos. And then behind what's called the continual group, so that would be, in this case, the bass and the harpsichord.
Mel Gibson on the harpsichord.
I thought it was Jeremy Hart.
Any other threes?
Threes within the violins, they speak to one another.
Right, yeah.
Iteration.
Right, you often had a statement just going down the section. One, two, three, yeah. And I know violas as well.
The solos switched, so it was every one of the three instruments
right.
had solos.
Yeah.
And
good.
It was a switch in rhythm to three. Uh-huh. I don't know how to actually say that in English, but it went from two to three.
Right.
After the cadenza?
Yes, yes.
And it was a switch.
So, it went into treble time to jump. Yeah. That's what they did. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. Good.
It really felt like a conversation.
Right.
Yes.
Doesn't it? Just, yeah.
Sometimes discussion or even like conflict or fight.
Right.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Like teasing each other, okay?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Incredible interaction. I mean, that performance, especially. Yeah. The chemistry.
And this lady with on the left second with the human, she was playing with your eyebrows. You
right.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Let me. One of the reasons I love the website, apart from wonderful performances like that, are you get a blurb. You know, you get a whole background to it, which is all free. By the way, you don't have to pay for this website at all. And wonderful observation here. Let me read you this. This is on the same webpage. You know, if you look this up. And in that explanation of what's going on here, you get this quote. This concerto is remarkable for its unusual form and instrumentation. Bach composed it for three violins, three violas, three cellos, and basso continuo. That's the basic obstacle. In other words, three by three, which is a rational choice you would expect from a modernist like Pierre Boulez rather than a Baroque composer like Bach. And notice this last statement, this is very significant, I think. There is no distinction between solo and ensemble instruments. All the strings play both solo and tutti. Okay, now some musical phrases here, solo and ensemble, I guess you've got that. The idea of solo and tutti, okay? In a conventional concerto, such as we heard in the Four Seasons, you will have a the solo violin, of course, accompanied by the tutti. Tutti is just Italian for all or everyone. And so a solo section is when the prima donna plays, as it were, the solo violin, and the tutti is the rest of the group. Notice this observation, there is no distinction between solo and ensemble instruments. All the strings do both, and we've noticed that already. Everyone seemed to take a turn in speaking, taking a solo part while everybody else accompanied, and it was distributed pretty equally, I think. Possibly the lead violinist had a bit more than everybody else, the guy with the white shirt. But this comment is so perceptive, isn't it? And you can imagine me punching the air when I came across this preparing these talks, because I knew this was coming up. After a session where I talked about modernists, I didn't mention Pierre Boulez this morning, but Pierre Boulez is really the high priest of modernism in the second half of the 20th century. Really took over the battle from Stravinsky in many ways as a very, very prominent modernist composer with a hugely uncompromising approach to composition based around modernist ideals, often with mathematical workings taking prominence, hence their comment there. What I find intriguing here is that these commentators expect a little play on numbers from Boulez, the modernist, but not from Bach, the Lutheran 18th century composer. They're mystified by it. And the key to the mystery, I believe, and not just me, but many scholars have picked up on this, is there some connection here with Trinitarian theology? Bach has written for three times three. We've seen that. Three groups of three, a tri-unity of tri-unities. Or we could put it another way, a trinity of trinities. And the number three is deeply embedded in the music itself. We've noticed this, and I think we might see a bit more in a moment. And that last sentence there is very telling and illuminating. There is no distinction between solo and ensemble instruments. All the strings play both solo and tutti. Explained about those. There are no prima donnas here. The usual form for the concerto has it, but there is no distinction between solo and ensemble instruments. Now, if it's true that Bach is here writing music inspired by his Trinitarian theology, isn't this a wonderful piece of symbolism? A reflection of the Trinity itself, of Trinitarian relationships, of the Godhead in whom no person grabs glory for himself, but gives glory to the other. This equality of conversation, who mentioned conversation? If you think about the divine conversation of the Godhead, where no person dominates, but gives glory, doesn't grab glory. The Son gives glory to the Father gives glory to the Son, all in the loving unity of the Spirit. There is no prima donna here. Every person gives glory to the other and does not push himself forward. Wouldn't that be a wonderful depiction of Trinity? It's got these guys mystified. Let's watch a little accompanying video. You don't only get notes on openbach.com, you get little video commentaries as well. And It's going to start off with a bit of general stuff, which is interesting background, and then we start to. Well, I won't spoil it. I'm going to cut it off after about 4 minutes. I won't play the whole video, but 4 minutes of this is well worth watching for our purposes. See what you think.
When the piece is so well known to everyone, I think everybody has their own little story. You know, I played this with that person or this group, and it was wonderful. And for me, this piece happens to be one of the very first pieces that I wanted to play and also ended up playing when I started the Baroque Violin. And I barely knew what gut strings were. Hadn't really held a bow so much in my life until then, and so it really it brings me back quite far, and so in that way, yeah, it excites something quite deep inside of me, this piece. Well, three, that's a number that Bach repeatedly uses, not just here, but throughout his oeuvre. And he literally takes this number three and he organizes three main groups, let's say, cellos, violas, and violins, and divides them further into three. So three groups of three. The one thing which I wouldn't want to shy away from, you know, this the significance of three, that the number three that happens anyway in so many of Bach's works, but this is kind of, you know, it's full frontal, numeric obsession happening in this one, you know. And I think we can take that a little bit more and show it in the sense of, yeah, all these repetitions, they all come in threes. All these sets of threes that we can, you know, it's just, we've heard it so many times, and that's a little bit of a problem sometimes. We forget these bits of things that are so clearly there. Can we have a bit of that? Really count yourselves once, twice, three times. You know, just show it to whoever's out there. I am not aware of any other piece that has followed in the footsteps of this one. It's a very special one also because these groups, they function very differently at different times. You know, sometimes the groups of three, so the violins, violas, cellos, they function as one group sometimes, and sometimes the three voices within each group, the three players within each group, they separate and they have a little brief solo here. Even just to look at the music, it makes you dizzy a little bit because there's just so much going on, and yet it's so coherent and clear, and it's a marvel to look at and to listen to. If scales sounded exciting, you know, this is it. You know, it's remarkable. It's one of the most simplest and most joyful, and yet most, you know, simple can very quickly become sort of repetitive and dull, and not a moment of that. I think the most noticeable, brilliant ones are the viola solo in the middle. Bach loved to play viola. He actually liked
And so on. I'm not going to play the rest of that. Do you see the mystery, though? The mystery of this three keeps coming up, and there's a quality of conversation and this self-deferential way of playing and giving other people prominence. And so that it's mystifying these musicians, as fantastic as they are. And yeah, isn't it an interesting thought that, and an attractive thought, that Bach, in one of his best-known and best-loved pieces, could be consciously reflecting, symbolizing the triune God he worshipped in his own acts of creation, his music. But was he? That's a good question I want us to finish with. All the evidence so far is circumstantial. The argument so far, as attractive as it might be to us as Christians, is from silence, well, not quite silence, but from music. But there's one more thing to consider here, just as we finish. It's thought that Bach composed that piece, the Brandenburg Concerto No. 3, around 1719 or 20, so a couple of years after Vivaldi and his Four Seasons. And at that time he was in Curtin, Germany. By 1729, Bach was working in Leipzig as Kapellmeister for the church there, and he was writing those weekly cantatas I mentioned earlier. So this is 10 years later now. Now for Pentecost Monday, notice the date, Pentecost Monday, the prescribed readings from the lectionary that Bach would have to consider and set to music would have been Peter's first sermon to Cornelius in Acts 10. Sorry, Peter's sermon, he didn't do more than one, in Acts 10, and Christ's conversation with Nicodemus in John 3. Acts 10, John 3. These are two rich passages chosen in the lectionary to highlight the Trinitarian work of Pentecost, the overflowing of the Trinity in Luther's own language, in the giving, the sending of the Holy Spirit by the Father and the Son, both in personal regeneration of the believer, that's Christ's conversation with Nicodemus in John 3, as well as the spread of the gospel to all nations in mission, as the gospel goes to the Gentiles too in Acts 10. So how does Bach open his cantata for Pentecost Monday, this feast steeped in Trinitarian celebration? Anybody guess? Copy and paste. Brandenburg Concerto No. 3, first movement, opens this cantata 10 years after he's composed it. Now I think the evidence is a little bit more than circumstantial, and the argument is for more than silence. But, you know, you can decide for yourselves on that one. But for me, that's a very, very exciting possibility. The Bach is symbolizing Trinity himself, our triune God, in his music. It's not representation. You know, how would you represent God? You're not going to do it in the same way that Vivaldi did in Four Seasons. But you can symbolize it in this very, very thoughtful way, and very personal. So I think we're pretty much done. Just to wrap it up, those are the two methods of carrying musical meaning. Something more than the physical properties of sound. Representation, perhaps the most direct way that composers can use, and symbolism, perhaps one of the more complex. This requires our careful attention, doesn't it? Listening to music in this way isn't a passive experience. But then, should art be a passive experience? At the very least, artists of all disciplines who have put their best efforts into an act of creation deserve our full attention, don't they? Listening, thinking about art in these kind of ways is not fashionable. I mentioned that this morning. And we might need to prioritise to find time to do that with the pressures of modern, and I use that word deliberately, modern life. But I hope we can appreciate that there's a richness and a significant reward to taking that time, to taking that trouble, to listen in that way. So apart from the example we used right at the beginning of this session, the Haydn, we've limited ourselves just to the first half of the 18th century this evening. We'll move forward, I trust, in the morning, and we'll see a lot more representation, and we'll see a lot more symbolism in future sessions. So if any of that's not quite clear, I hope it will be with more examples. So there's a lot more to to crack on with. But I think for now, we'll wrap up there. But does anybody have any questions or observations? Or we could just listen to Bach.
It did feel as though it could have gone on and on and on.
Right.
I mean, you know, not coming to an end.
Yes. Yeah, there's something sort of, yeah, perpetual movement.
Yeah.
Perpetual motion. Yeah. There's something quite ecstatic about it. Ambulant, yeah.
I was enjoying watching Katya's face.
Did you do that?
You just had a great big grin on your face.
Well,
what other way, you said symbolism is more subtle and difficult, and here we see a numerical thing that's going on in music, but it's, what other ways of symbolism, or will we explore some?
Yeah, tune in tomorrow for
well, not everyone will be here tomorrow.
So okay, well,
anyone planning on stuffing it overnight?
Yeah. Just being thought.
Thanks.
There are many other ways. We're going to talk about topic tomorrow, but that's quite technical. That needs a little bit of explanation. We'll see.
I mean, if you listen to Bach, so that's probably my favorite bit of Bach. It's really enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
I've got lots of Bach recordings, and I try listening to many of them, it seems to require effort.
Yeah.
Can't you stick it on the binder?
No. Mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm.
And I struggle to get into it, quite
right.
honestly.
Yeah.
So what would you, to help someone to access that sort of richness that you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
which Bach devotees would seem to see and hear?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, help an ignoramus like me to do that.
Yeah. I mean, I think you're right. I mean, you're right on the money there when you say, you know, I can't have that on as background music. I don't think I could either. You know, this is brilliant music. I mean, in the same way that you can't sort of have a Michelangelo in the background. You know, it demands your attention. It demands your full attention. You know, and I think also at the same time, you know, I'm not saying because you're a Christian you have to like Bach. You know, you might just prefer Prokofiev, and that's okay. But you know, if you want to explore it to find out if you really do like. I think it requires that kind of dedicated listening, you know, that, you know, I don't know when it was that I spotted, you know, those phrases coming through times, da-da-dee, da-da-da, da-da-dee, da-da-da, da-da-dee, da-da. Oh, that's another three, you know, some of those things, I don't know, 20, 30 times before I noticed that, you know, through. So there is that sense of just listening and then immersing as well. And I think the vocal music as well, it gives a big entrance into Bach's world and the language Bach speaks. When you work through the passions, for example. Because that's when you get the words being sung. The biblical texts often, with some of Bach's music then woven around that to complement it. That's often a great way to begin to become conversant with his language and so on.
I've heard Jeremy Bars say that in Japan they talk about Bach being the fifth gospel.
Right, yeah. A huge following.
Where would you start then if you were wanting to dip your toe into Bach, or like immerse your toe?
Okay. Let me go out another. I'd say this is John Passion.
Right.
The two surviving passion is Eastern music, so it would be the sections from the Gospels that would basically deal with events leading up to Good Friday, traditionally performed on Good Friday. So we'll end up with Christ on the cross being buried. A different piece would come out for Easter Sunday. So the Passions, we only have two surviving ones, John and Matthew. The Matthew is possibly, arguably, Bach's greatest work, but it's also very long. John, like John's Gospel, is quite succinct and quite ordered, and so it's probably a little bit easier musically to get into, and so on. You would get through, it's still a couple of hours. But I would say Yeah. Well, you know, you can take part one, you can take an hour.
Yeah, we'll see later.
But I would say, yeah, I would say if you really, you know, that in mind, you're the fifth gospel. You know, think the St. John Passion, because that's probably an easier piece to get into than the St. Matthew, which is more of a kind of colossal.
How would you spot other symbolism in Bach's in terms of numbers? Is there any other clues you can give us? Other numbers, or
no? I mean the three. I mean he referred to it there. Three is the big one. You know, yeah, he said it's in all of his work. It's not just in this one, but this one particularly. So I'm not aware. There are some structural things actually in the Passions. Some people see 12 sections in the Matthew Passion, for example. And like associated with the 12 stations of the cross and things like that. But generally, it's the three that you want to really pick out.
I'm curious to know how much representation and symbolism crosses cultures, and how much is human and how much is cultural.
Right. In terms of the.
As in, there's an innateness and understanding of the music. Representation and symbolism compared to being connected into a cultural type.
Right.
So it's either a human response or is it a cultural response?
Yeah, I mean that once you get into the crossing culture, you know, you get into sort of ethnomusicology and so on, study of the music of other cultures, which is really not my area. So I wouldn't like to comment on it, but I think, I think there's probably a little bit of both. I think there's some universal aspects that, you know, if we took someone from a culture not our own and said, play them the Vivaldi, you know, does it sound wintry to you? How much of that is conditioned by exposure to other wintry music, you know? And how much of that is a universal
exposure to winter, in fact.
Right, yes. Yeah, so I don't know would be the answer. It's not right. But I think that would be, I suspect the answer would be a bit of both, if that's not fudging the answer a bit. I suspect there's probably a little bit of universal, yeah, I can see that, and then a bit of, no, I don't see that. In the same way as when we cross cultures, we kind of see things and we kind of go, oh, I'm not quite sure I got that yet.
Japan's certainly a pretty different culture.
Right. Yeah, I mean, that is, yeah.
More human and more innate to us as human beings,
right?
Like, as a universal experience rather than as a
right. Yes.
Our understanding of discussion is that, I mean, this is about Bach, but you mentioned Luther and you mentioned his background, you listen to philosophy, you're thinking
right.
All those things
yes.
Added onto the music. I'm just wondering where does music in itself as a human experience?
Yeah.
I mean,
no, but it's a fast. I mean, it's a huge subject, but I mean, and there's a big interest in that now with this kind of looking across culture to see, that's a really interesting. But yeah, I mean, the huge popularity of Bach in Japan is an interesting one. Yeah, what is it about Bach's music that really seems to strike a chord? You know, that really seems to. Oh, all these musical puns resonate, I want to say now. You know,
you're stringing us along. I can stop talking. You should call out at this point.
Good. Well, unless there's any more questions, you've done very well sticking with preaching Bach to you till after 9 o'clock. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let me just pause the recording.
Don't put this on the recording.